Welcome, everyone. Thank you very much for coming to the Center for European Studies today. I'm Grzegorz, I'm the director of the center, and it's my great pleasure to welcome Timothy Snyder here for the August Zaleski Memorial Lecture in Modern Polish History. The lecture series was founded in 1983 by the generous gift from estate of August Zaleski's widow, Ewelina Zaleska. And the series of lectures we have had over the last 20 years or so are focusing on various aspects of Polish history and politics. Let me thank Mrs. Marlina Weintraub, who was very instrumental in organizing and funding the Zaleski lecture. And I would like to thank Elaine Papoulias and the staff of the Center for European Studies for all the hard work they invested in this event. Now, Mr. Zaleski was educated in London School of Economics and was a Polish politician, economist, and diplomat. He was twice the Minister of Foreign Affairs of Poland, and then he served as the President of Poland in Polish government in exile. This year, Zaleski lecture will have two components, so you will get two for the price of one. So today is the lecture, and tomorrow at noon we have a seminar with a group of distinguished Harvard historians who will be discussing Timothy Snyder's book. Now, Timothy Snyder is not a stranger to this place. We had the pleasure of having him at the center many times in the past. He is the Bert White Hausmann Professor of History at Yale University, specializing in Central and East European history. He has a degree from Brown University and then PhD from Oxford University. He was a British Marshall Scholar at Baylor College, and he was the Harvard Academy Scholar for Area and International Studies. He has written five very important books, which were translated in many languages. Let me just briefly mention the titles. The first one was about Kazimierz Keles-Kraus, the forgotten Polish Marxist thinker. And then there was a book about reconstruction of nations on Poland, Ukraine, Lithuania, and Belarus. Then Sketches from the Secret War, about the Polish artist's mission to liberate Soviet Ukraine. And then The Red Prince, The Secret Lives of Habsburg Archduke. And Bloodlands, you probably know this one very well. It was translated into 25 languages. And today and tomorrow we will discuss the latest book, which probably will be translated to even more languages than 25. Timothy Snyder also widely wrote in various journals. He edited a couple of volumes. He helped late Tony Judd to put together a book on thinking the 20th century. So it's quite amazing and distinguished achievements over the last many years. So it is my great pleasure to welcome you, Tim, to the CES, and the floor is yours.
Okay. Thank you. Grzegorz, thank you very much. I can't tell you how great a pleasure it is to be here. I have sat where you are sitting many, many, many more times than I have stood where I am standing. This place rescued me a couple of decades ago when I, as Grzegorz mentioned, was so unwise as to commit three major academic mistakes right at the beginning of my career. I wrote a dissertation at Oxford. I did it in 3 years, and I wrote it about a Polish Marxist. After which this place, which was then directed by Stanley Hoffman and then by Charlie Mayer, who very kindly took me to lunch very regularly, despite these various sins, afterwards this place rescued me and helped to make me a historian, and I'm very grateful for that. I'm very grateful also to have my name on the list of the lecturers. This is a list of lecturers which includes my doctoral supervisor, which includes my predecessor at Yale, which includes many people with whom I've studied, as well as many people with whom I wish I had studied, and a great number of my friends. So in that way, it's an honor as well. And the name Zaleski, in a way, leads us very nicely into the subject, because the name brings us to the history of Poland of the 1920s and 1930s, the history of the Polish state. And one of the tasks that we have before us, if we want to be serious about the history of the Holocaust, is making the history of the Polish state a subject that intersects with the history of what we think we know about the Holocaust. And there, I suppose, is where I ought to begin. My title, my subject, the Holocaust in Poland, assumes that we all know, or that we all share certain assumptions about what the Holocaust was, what actually happened, and why it happened. And I would like to problematize that from the very beginning. To be sure, we can all agree that the Holocaust of the European Jews was a mass murder which took the lives of almost 6 million children, women, and men between 1941 and 1944. To be sure, we can agree that this was a German policy led by Germans during this time. And of course, we can agree that this policy, as a policy of mass killing, began in 1941 with the invasion of the Soviet Union. But what do we have in common after that? What I would like to suggest at the very beginning is that when we speak of the Holocaust here or there, the Holocaust as memory or the Holocaust as discourse, we are very often implying something which is not really the case, namely that we have an adequate total history of the Holocaust, of which other things are simply examples, descriptions, manifestations, or representations. I think this is actually not the case. And so what I would like to do, in fact, what I think we need to do together, if we're going to be serious about the Holocaust in Poland, or serious about the Holocaust in Poland and its controversies, is to first get some sense of what we mean by an interpretation of the Holocaust. So in this time that we'll spend together, I will be trying to do two things on parallel tracks. Well, not really parallel tracks, because they will meet at certain points. I will be trying to provide an explanation of the Holocaust, which is true to what we know about Polish society and the Polish state. Well, at the same time, bringing in particularities which are specific to this case. Okay. Now, there is a basic premise to this attempted explanation. And if you don't share this basic premise, now would be a good time to go. And it would be thoughtful because there are people upstairs who don't have seats who are watching on television. So, you know, the basic premise is this, that no national framework can capture interpretively the history of the Holocaust, and that attempts to reduce the explanation of the Holocaust to ethnic stereotypes are not only analytically wrong, but morally and politically rather dangerous. In other words, the assumption is that we need an explanation of the Holocaust which accounts for its European and indeed international character, and which gets us away from, and at no point relies upon, ethnic stereotypes. Now, that is harder than it sounds, because both in the popular discussions, of which I've had the pleasure to have rather a lot, in journalistic discussions and in academic discussions, one does not go very far before one hits the escape valve of those orderly Germans, those disorderly Slavs, or those communist Jews. And depending upon where one is, that different, each of those stereotypes will have a different resonance. Each of them will have a different level of acceptability. All of them are, however, ethnic stereotypes, and none of them is innocent. So the explanatory, but as well as the moral premise of this discussion, is that we need an explanation which does not lead us to those places, which allows us not to seek those exit routes. Okay, now, Germany. When I say that there is no adequate consensus interpretation of how the Holocaust happened, your natural response would then be to say, what about the history of Germany? Does not the history of Germany, as narrated through the 1930s into the early 1940s, provide some kind of template? Can we not discuss the Holocaust in Poland or the Holocaust in X country on the basis of what we know of the Holocaust in Germany? The answer to that question is categorically no, we cannot, because there was no Holocaust in Germany as such. Now let me be very precise about what I mean by that. Between Hitler's rise to power in 1933 and the beginning of the Second World War in 1939, and indeed the invasion of the Soviet Union in 1941, there was no event anywhere which we can call a Holocaust. And on the territory of pre-war Germany itself, there was never an event which we could categorize as a Holocaust. To be sure, German Jews die. Fewer than half of them, most of them immigrate, and the number of German Jews is tiny compared to the number of European Jews. But if it were only German Jews doing the dying, that would not be something which we would qualify as a Holocaust, right? And to go further, not only was there not a Holocaust in Germany, there could not have been a Holocaust in Germany, both for statistical and for analytical reasons. Let me be very precise about the numbers. When Germany begins the Second World War, the Jewish population of Germany is 0.25%, not 25%, God help us, 0.25%. Most of those people, most of the German Jews who were in Germany in 1933, as I've said, are going to survive. 97% of the Jewish victims of the Holocaust are Jews who have nothing whatsoever to do with Germany until German power arrives and kills them, right? These people do not speak German, which, among other things, means they did not leave sources behind in the German language, although they very often did in Yiddish or Russian or Polish. Even the German Jews who were killed in the Holocaust almost always have to be sent beyond the territory of pre-war Germany to places like Riga or Łódź or Minsk in order to be killed, which is also very significant. Half of the killers in the Holocaust, roughly, we can never be sure precisely, but roughly half of the killers in the Holocaust were also not German. Or, just one more fact, all of the German killers in the Holocaust, all of the major ones, also killed people who were not Jews, right? Without exception, they all did. And then beyond that, all of the major German killers in the Holocaust, as a rule, there are some exceptions, did not carry out crimes of a scale on the territory of pre-war Germany, right? The way they behaved in pre-war Germany was very different from the way they behaved beyond Germany. Now, all of these, admittedly in a negative way, I think require us to push beyond traditional national narratives, traditional German narratives, in our attempt to understand the Holocaust. But we have not, in general, done so, right? There's a bit of a bait and switch where we speak of the Holocaust in X, Y, or Z on the assumption that the Holocaust has been handled by a German narrative, when it not only has not been, but it cannot be. And this is the point where I have to say something about the historical strike. So the historical strike, on which Charlie Mayer's book, along with Peter Baldwin's excellent collection, remains a wonderful guide. The historical strike, I think, is best seen as an exercise in nation building within Germany in the late 1980s. Neither position in the historical strike actually allows us fruitfully to carry out with the business of explaining the Holocaust. So just to remind you, there were two basic positions in the historical strike, which at the time was seen as the major debate about the Holocaust. The first position, the position which started the entire debate, the Nolte position, was that one could understand dialectically German behavior on the basis of Soviet behavior. Now that position happens to be fundamentally empirically wrong. None of Nolte's major examples actually work. There are some places where the Soviets and Germans interact. I read about it in Bloodlands. But basically, Nolte is applying a kind of speculative Hegelian framework where he assumes that for every German reaction, there must have been a Soviet action. Obviously unsatisfactory. On the other hand, the Habermasian position, which assumes that there is a German life form and that debates about the Holocaust within Germany are more important than understanding the event itself, is also, although not as obviously, also a kind of colonialist position. And I use that because Habermas spoke of Nolte's position as colonialist. Okay, that's fine. But a position which authorizes the discussion of German history without the use of non-German sources and on the assumption that it's a business above all or exclusively of Germans is also a kind of imperialist position. because what it has done in the field of German history is prevented German history from doing what every other field of colonial or imperial history has done. In other words, embrace the languages of the victims, embrace the languages of the occupied peoples, and write history dialogically or triologically. That has not happened, with some exceptions, in the history of the Holocaust. And the point about language is, makes this point brutally obvious. Every German historian could put on headphones at night for 6 weeks and learn Yiddish, right? It's not hard to learn Yiddish if you're a native German speaker. If you don't know, ask yourselves, find out how many German historians of the Holocaust have learned Yiddish since 1989, right? I'll put it this way, I'm not gonna claim that it's zero. But it is frighteningly close to zero. And given the abundance of sources on the Holocaust in Yiddish, which to repeat is a Germanic language which a native German speaker can learn, I might be exaggerating with the headphones at night, but in a summer course, right, this is shocking. I won't make the same point about Polish and Russian because those are authentically hard languages, but Yiddish is the clue that something is fundamentally wrong. The other problems with the way the historical strike turns out are that you end up with a kind of narrative black hole, where in the major works on the Holocaust, which have proceeded since the 1980s, what we have are precisely sophisticated accounts of Germany in the 1930s, which when you get beyond Germany, fall into, to put it politely, a kind of tabula rasa. Since there are no sources available which are non-German sources, all one can do is critically use the German sources. And I want to suggest that the Jewish sources and also the non-Jewish East European sources are not only important as a matter of dignity to read, but they also provide important information about causality. The second major inheritance of the Historikerstreit, which is problematic, is the taboo on the Soviet Union. Right? Because Nolte so egregiously abused the history of the Soviet Union about which he knew nothing, in order to make this dialectical case about German history, a very severe taboo was placed on the study of the Soviet Union, which is a tremendous problem for the history of the Holocaust itself, for manifold reasons, right? So many Soviet Jews died. So many Soviet citizens took part. And the Holocaust began, last but not least, when Germany invades the Soviet Union. So for reasons I'm going to try to amplify below, one cannot talk about the Holocaust as German history or even as Polish history without the Soviet Union. Okay, that brings me to controversies in Poland. So I hope I've established the basic point, which is that if we're discussing a controversy in Polish historiography about the Holocaust, we have to keep the idea of the Holocaust itself open, because during controversies in Poland about the Holocaust, the assumption would be, much as it was in Germany, that we all know what the Holocaust is, right? And that is simply not the case. During the Historikerstreit, if one actually goes back and reads the texts, the level of knowledge about the Holocaust is frankly shockingly low, right? Shockingly low compared to what is known now. And it's combined with the assumption that we fundamentally have the factography under control. That's startling. In the debate that takes place in Poland, the very important debate after the publication of Jan Gross's book Neighbors in Poland in November of 2000, if one looks at that very important debate, one sees something rather similar. Jan Gross writes that this is a rather typical book about the Holocaust, which raises the question of what a typical book about the Holocaust is. There is no typical book about the Holocaust in 2000, just as there is no typical book about the Holocaust now. It's an extraordinarily interesting book about the Holocaust, which makes extraordinarily interesting arguments about causality, some of which I try to follow up in Black Earth, but all of which essentially were ignored in the debate that followed. What happened after the publication of Jan Gross's book in 2000 is that, very much like in Germany in the late 80s, you know, but roughly a decade and a half later, this became an important dispute about Polish nation building. Where both sides are concerned about the state of Polish society, they simply have different visions about what Polish society should be. Neighbors played the important ice-breaking role of destroying for all time, one thinks perhaps, the Polish myth of national innocence and the Polish habit, which was born of Stalinism, of equating Polish suffering with Jewish suffering. That's, by the way, a Stalinist myth. We can return to that. It undoes that, I think, forever. And that is its ice-breaking role. However, the debate becomes, for perfectly understandable reasons, precisely a debate about national virtue. And it has remained that kind of discussion, discussion about ethnic honor, primarily since. Interestingly, this debate replicates some of the problems with the German debate. To a startling degree, Polish historiography in that book and in succeeding books only uses Polish language sources, right? Which was the problem of the German historiography and remains the problem of the German historiography. Like the German debate, as I mentioned, there's this assumption that we all know what happened in the Holocaust, which in Poland is simply not the case. It's not the case in Germany either, by the way. But in Poland, it's simply not the case. And interestingly, you have the regeneration of the same taboo on the Soviet Union, right? Because in this argument about ethnic honor, what the position which is trying to defend ethnic honor says, well, yes, some Poles killed some Jews. That, of course, was Jan Gross's big finding, which has been confirmed in multiple levels by wonderful and important studies since then. Yes, Poles killed Jews in the summer of 1941, right, on the scale of several dozen pogroms, something on the order of 20,000 people killed. Yes, okay, but, say the defenders of Polish ethnic honor, this was possible because Jews collaborated with communists, right? And then the counter thrust from Gross and from others has to be, that's not significant, that doesn't matter, and let's not talk about that, right? And I agree that it didn't matter, right? Where I don't, it actually doesn't, we'll get to that, but where I don't agree is that one therefore can put a taboo on Soviet history. If you put a taboo on Soviet history, you're not gonna be able to explain the Holocaust. And then there's another point of really interesting overlap, which is that in this debate, the default explanation, and I only know this because I asked people, right, in Poland. I mean, I asked people, okay, so you have this really important discussion of 1941. And then since then, there have been very important books about 1943, which is after the mass actions, after Polish Jews have been deported to the gas chambers, a couple of 100,000 Polish Jews are trying to survive on the countryside. And many, if not most of them, are murdered by Poles or by German policemen. There have been several significant studies of that, right? So the very, very beginning and the very, very end of the Holocaust have been studied. So I ask then Polish colleagues, but what is the default explanation of the Holocaust? And the answer is anti-Semitism. Okay. That's an interesting overlap with the German discussion in the following, I think, very interesting way. Where the German discussion leads us is, let's write extraordinarily interesting and sophisticated summaries of Germany in the 1930s. Let's take German society very seriously. Let's treat the rise to power of Hitler as a difficult problem. Let's treat the Gleichschaltung as a complex process. And then the moment that Germany invades other countries, the dam breaks. No need for political sophistication, no need to understand other societies besides German ones. All one has to really know is that these places had a lot of anti-Semitism, right? And then that becomes the default explanation. That cooperates very nicely with the assumption in Poland that among Polish researchers, right, I'm not saying this is a consensus in Polish society, among Polish researchers that the fundamental cause of the Holocaust in Poland was anti-Semitism. Now, that I think is a consensus of convenience. And when I say consensus of convenience, I mean, first, it's what a lot of people think, but also second, you're generally not going to go wrong criticizing anti-Semitism. Right? In general, if you stand up and say the Holocaust was caused by anti-Semitism, people are going to nod, right? In general, they're going to say yes, of course, because we want to condemn anti-Semitism, and rightfully so. And in the political moment of Poland today, we want to condemn all, let's say, malignant references or misunderstanding references to the 1920s and 1930s, of which there are unfortunately ever more, right? One would want to do that. And associating anti-Semitism or claiming that it's the basic cause of the Holocaust seems like a convenient way of condemning anti-Semitism. What I want to suggest is that A, the things that are convenient are not always true, and B, it's probably important to check, okay? So let's check. If Polish anti-Semitism were the simple and overwhelming explanation of the Holocaust in Poland, or by extension in other countries, there are two fundamental problems of chronology. The first is the 500-year problem. Jews lived in Poland for better or worse, or mostly for mediocre, for half a millennium, right? For half a millennium, in large numbers, in larger numbers than anywhere else, right? In 1938, there are more Jews in Łódź than in Palestine, just to keep things in proportion. And then in basically 1 year, 1942, the vast majority of Polish Jews are murdered. If anti-Semitism were the explanation, we have a hard time with the 500 years, because anti-Semitism has a long and strong tradition, right? Precisely because it is so ubiquitous and durable in Polish intellectual and social history, it does not work very well as an explanation for why 3 million Jews were killed roughly in 1942. The other chronology problem, which I'm going to focus on a bit more later, we could call 1938 and 1943. Why did people in Poland behave so differently in 1938 than they did in 1943? Or to put it more sharply, why did many people who were working in a way to protect Jews in 1938 take part in their mass murder in 1943? I'm going to return to that. The other problem that the anti-Semitism explanation has is with comparison, right? With comparison. So let's look beyond Poland for a moment. Let's take the hypothesis that pre-war anti-Semitism is our explanation for the Holocaust. How does this work in the two countries in interwar Europe that had the two that had no problem with mass political anti-Semitism in the 1930s, Greece and the Netherlands? It works very poorly indeed. Those are two countries which have among the highest rates of Jewish death during the Holocaust, both the cases around 75%. And we could compare them, to take a familiar West European case, with France. Unlike Greece and the Netherlands, France has a major problem with public anti-Semitism in the 1930s, and yet the death rate in France is roughly 25%. I don't think that the explanation for anti-Semitism can survive that comparison. And one can make these comparisons over and over. What about Poland? Let's make a comparison with Poland. Let's compare Poland with Romania. Was Poland really a more anti-Semitic country than Romania in the 1930s? I would claim not. In any event, Poland was not governed by an anti-Semitic regime. Poland did not have a government which carried out a policy of the mass murder of Jews. Romania was an explicitly anti-Semitic regime which had its own policy of carrying out a mass murder of Jews. And yet, a Jew in Romania was twice as likely to survive as a Jew in Poland. How does one explain that? I don't think Polish anti-Semitism is going to give us the answer to that. Or let's consider this. Poles in France were more likely to be killed, Polish Jews in France were more likely to be killed than French Jews in France. A lot more likely to be killed than French Jews in France. In fact, in absolute, not relative terms, more Polish Jews will die in the French Holocaust, in absolute numbers, than French Jews. I think you have a hard time making Polish anti-Semitism the explanation of that. And indeed, that raises questions, right? It raises questions about why precisely those people will die. And of course, the answer is that they've been deprived of all state protection, and I'm going to return to that. Now, let's make the comparison in a different way. Let's compare Poland and the Soviet Union. This is a different kind of comparison because, right, very few of you, I'll wait for Q&A, but very few of you will say interwar Poland was very much like interwar Soviet Union, right? Very few of you will say that public anti-Semitism in the Soviet Union was like public anti-Semitism in Poland, right? Very few of you will say Polish national democracy had its analog in the right-wing movement in the Soviet Union and so on and so forth, right? The Soviet Union had problems in the 1930s, but it was the only anti-Semitic state in the world at the time, in fact, in the history of the world at that time, right? Nevertheless, the percentage of Jews who die in Poland and the occupied Soviet Union is exactly the same. Exactly the same, circa 95% in both of those countries. So if you're going to take anti-Semitism as your explanation, you have to explain to me then, or to yourself rather, because I'm already convinced, you have to explain to yourself how you get the same percentage in the Soviet Union and also why it was so high in the Soviet Union. Why it was so high, why it was just as high in the Soviet Union as it was in Poland. Okay. So this brings me to a place where you know I was always going, which is that we have to make sure in our explanation that the Soviet Union does not go missing. Not just because Poland and the Soviet Union are the two places where the death rates are above 90%. Not just because Poland and the Soviet Union are the two largest Jewish communities in Europe. Not just because almost all of the victims, not almost all, the huge majority of the victims are either Polish or Soviet, or Polish or Soviet citizens. Not just because the Soviet Union is the way, is the place where the Holocaust began, but also because Soviet citizens were by far the largest number of armed collaborators in the Holocaust. For all of those reasons, we simply cannot have the Soviet Union out. Okay, so much for the destruction job. Now let me try to spend the second half on explanation. How then might we build an explanation which would learn from German controversies and Polish controversies, which would learn from German history and Polish history, but which would also be consistent with what we know about the Holocaust as a whole? I would make three kinds of arguments. The first has to do with Germany in the 1930s. I think our bad habit with Germany in the 1930s is to treat it one way or the other as a kind of finished, perfect bureaucratic machine. The German state as an institution which was capable of the Holocaust, right? It was not. The German state as of 1939 on German territory was not capable of a Holocaust, and not for lack of trying, not for lack of trying things out. By comparison to how quickly destruction is achieved beyond the boundaries of Germany, that whole story, right, of Germany from 33 to 1939, the whole story of Nuremberg laws, expropriation, and so on, seems very, very slow indeed, and that should alert us to something. I would say the way to understand Germany is not as a perfect machine, but as an unconventional state with an unprecedented racial potential for murder. What do I mean by that? The Weberian definition of the state, see, if anybody's sleeping, the phrase Weberian definition of the state always wakes them up, right? So I make sure to put it in every talk. The Weberian definition of the state, the aspiration to control legitimate means of violence is violated in fascism. In fascism, you come to power with some kind of special group of paramilitary, of thugs, right? And then the trick is, after you come to power, you keep them. This means that the state actually does not aspire to total control of violence on its own territory. This may seem like a trivial technical point, but it's not. What it means is that in a state like Germany, you have two separate organizations which have different claims on violence. The German state, which of course is very important, but also the SS. The SS is not part of the German state. It's a party apparatus, and it has control of violence in the camps, right? And this is how the concentration camps are important. Not because the concentration camps are where the Holocaust took place, which, by the way, almost all Germans still believe, even though it's just patently not true. Not because the camps in Germany in the 1930s are the template for the Holocaust. They're generally not. Not because the Jews of Germany will die in German camps. Generally, they don't. But because the camps are a zone of statelessness. They're a place where the SS can do literally what it wants. And that is important because what the SS primarily is, it's not a repressive institution inside Germany, right? Not particularly. What the SS is a racial organization which will destroy states beyond Germany, therefore, thereby creating the conditions in which a final solution, a Holocaust, will actually be possible. Okay. Where does ideology fit into all of this? This is perfectly consistent with the ideology, right? Mein Kampf, which is now a bestseller across more platforms, internet and otherwise, than I care to name, Mein Kampf is actually a fairly coherent text on these issues. In Mein Kampf, Hitler defines the Jews not as a racial enemy, that's a major misunderstanding. He defines the Jews as the group, the non-human, the para-human group, not subhuman, non-human group, that changes the world by bringing in ideas. For Hitler, the world should be an endless racial struggle for land and food. And insofar it does not seem to be such, this is because Jews have brought into our mind ideas like Christianity and communism, which Hitler says are basically the same thing, right? St. Paul and Trotsky, says Hitler, are the same person. St. Paul was the political commissar of Christianity, says Hitler, right? This can go on and on. But the basic point is that every idea which we take for granted is somehow cutting across conflict, whether it is the legal contract, whether it is the social contract, whether it's Christian mercy, whether it's working class solidarity, for Hitler, all these ideas are basically the same, and they're all Jewish. What is often overlooked in this account or on this list is the state itself. Hitler says that the state itself, the rule of law state, is not the goal of the race. He says that when the true racial conflict begins, the states will dissolve, right? And this is an important key in the text of Mein Kampf to what, in fact, will actually happen. The Holocaust will play itself out as and insofar states are destroyed. Okay. Now this brings me to the second gesture that I want to make, the second claim that I want to make, which is, see, I have this feeling this could work better. The second claim that I want to make, which has to do with, yeah, right? There we are. Which has to do with Poland. When we make arguments about the Holocaust, we very often start with the moment when Jews die, or we start even after they are dead. There's a basic analytical problem, I think, here, which is that in order to understand how someone is deprived of life, one first has to have at least a basic notion of how they lived before that, because carrying out mass killing is not as easy as it looks. It requires removing the structures, political, social, that had maintained life beforehand. We do not notice this because of a narrative sleight of hand. The narrative sleight of hand is we only notice Austria, Czechoslovakia, Poland, the Baltic states, and the Soviet Union after those places have been destroyed as states or dismantled as polities. What I try to do in this book, and what I'm very briefly going to do in this argument, is claim that in order to understand how Jews could have been killed in such numbers, one has to have some sense of the structures that kept them alive up to that point. And when one does this, when one writes the history of Austria or Czechoslovakia or Poland into the history of the Holocaust, then the causality also comes clearer. Just think for a minute. In what book about the Holocaust does Austria appear before the moment of Anschluss, right? Basically none. In what book does Czechoslovakia appear before it's destroyed in March of 1939? Basically none. In what book does Poland appear before September 1939? In what book is the Molotov-Ribbentrop Pact even mentioned, right? So, and if you make just the briefest of gestures at these states, then one begins to see the conditions in which Jews can live and therefore in which they can be killed. Austria, very briefly, March of 1938. What happens in Austria? The Austrian state, literally from one day to the next, ceases to exist. There's an evening, it's a Sabbath evening, Jews are listening to the radio anyway, right? Because the Chancellor of Austria makes an announcement, it's 1757, that essentially he's capitulated to Hitler and the Austrian state has ceased to exist. It is the next morning when the scrubbing parties, right? The notorious quote-unquote scrubbing parties on the streets of and sidewalks of Vienna begin. What are the Jews scrubbing from the streets of Vienna? It's not a random act of humiliation. 4 days later, on the 15th of March, 1938, there was to be a referendum to confirm the independence of Austria. And the slogan of that referendum was Österreich, the word Austria, which was whitewashed by Austrian tradition on the streets, right? The Jews were always, every single time, removing that whitewash. There was a political significance to this ritual of humiliation, which was the Jews are being associated with the state that is being destroyed, and the onlookers are separating themselves simultaneously from the Jews and from the state by watching, by staring, and by laughing. Czechoslovakia. All of these histories, Austria, Czechoslovakia, Poland, Lithuania, Latvia, Estonia, they all have their national version, which I'm happy to tell. But what I'm trying to tell now is the civic version. What does the destruction of these states look like from the point of view of the citizens, in particular the citizens most threatened? Consider Czechoslovakia. Forget about Munich and betrayal, which it was a betrayal, but forget about it for a moment. Think about the end of the state. What happens to the Jews? Czechoslovakia breaks up into three parts. The Jews of Bohemia and Moravia are annexed to the Reich as part of the so-called protectorate. They will have the greatest chance of survival. The greatest chance of survival. The ones that enter Nazi Germany will have the greatest chance of survival. Second part, Slovakia. When Slovakia is created as a new state, there is a moment when all of the prior citizens float free, right? Everyone is a non-citizen, and then is reinscribed civically by a new constitution in which the Jews are a second-class citizens, in which they don't have property rights, which leads very quickly to the generation of an artificial Jewish question, which means that the Slovak Jews are the first European Jews to be sent en masse to Auschwitz. Third group, furthest east of Czechoslovakia. And I'm an East European historian, which means that the more obscure it is, the more important it is. Subcarpathian Ruthenia. I get a smile from Rupnik. It's all been worthwhile. Subcarpathian Ruthenia. What happens in Subcarpathian Ruthenia? Somebody will know. It always turns out that there's someone from Subcarpathian Ruthenia in every audience. What happens in Subcarpathian Ruthenia is that the southernmost part of it is given over to Hungary. Hungary does not make the Jews second-class citizens. It doesn't recognize those Jews as citizens at all. And when the occasion arises, in the summer of 1941, it will deport them, which direction? East, which means where? Into Soviet Ukraine, into the path of the Wehrmacht, where those Jews and none other will be the group that is the target of the first mass shooting in the history of the world. That is the first mass shooting of more than 10,000 civilians at once, not only in the history of the Holocaust, but in the history of the world. And that's a story that begins with the destruction of Czechoslovakia. Okay, Poland. When Poland is destroyed in 1939, it's a special case because Poland is the first place where the Germans can destroy the state by way of military force. And they destroy it drastically. They send in the Einsatzgruppen and these special SS task forces to make the state impossible. They declare that the Polish state has never existed. They declare that this Polish civil code no longer functions. They declare that all Polish state and all Jewish property will become German property. Ghettoization is, among other things, the deprivation of property rights, right? We know that story. It's very dramatic. What I want to draw your attention to is this. The Holocaust does not happen in 1939. It does not happen even when Jews are put into ghettos in late 1940 and early 1941, right? Ghettoization is awful. The death rates are terrible. The ratio of births to deaths is something like 1 to 45. Tens of thousands of Jews die of malnutrition, mostly Jews from the countryside who were pushed into the larger ghettos. That's awful, but it's not yet the Holocaust. Between 1939, after the German invasion of 1949, 2 years have to pass more, 2 years and 3 months, before a Holocaust in Poland begins. Why is that? Why is that? Now here, Jan Gross's important book only sharpens the issue. Because what Gross writes about in July 1941 is a pogrom at that decisive turning point where Germany betrays the Soviet Union, right? Remember, Germany and the Soviet Union are allies now. Germany betrays the Soviet Union, invades the Soviet Union, and a pogrom breaks out in Jedwabne. We learn that there are many others at the same time. But this only sharpens the question, because that pogrom in Jedwabne, awful though it was, does not lead to the Holocaust in and of itself. The pogroms in and around Jedwabne go on for about 2 weeks, and then they stop. And when the Holocaust begins in Poland, 6 months later, it's by an entirely different means, right? In most of Poland, it will be by moving Jews from ghettos to gas chambers. So there's a question here, which is precisely, why do these pogroms stop? And why do they stop in eastern Poland when they do not stop in the Baltic states? Why do they stop in eastern Poland when they do not stop in the Soviet Union, right? That seems to me to be the crucial question, and one more reason why we have to talk about the Soviet Union. Okay, so you know, this is the third part of my explanation, the USSR. You know some of the major reasons why we have to talk about the Soviet Union. The Holocaust begins in terms of mass shooting when these Einsatzgruppen, the same units that had destroyed Poles in 1939, destroy Soviet communists and Jews in 1941. That's the first time that people shoot Jews in large numbers, right? When the Einsatzgruppen follow the Wehrmacht into the Soviet Union in 1941. We know, although I'm going to put this in a slightly unconventional way, we know that the SS finds it relatively easy in the Soviet Union to recruit other kinds of German units, German policemen, many of whom did not have any special training, and German soldiers, most of whom had no special training, to recruit these people in this time and place, in this special zone, during this war of extermination, where the Germans had declared this state doesn't exist and will never arise, that German SS had a relatively easy time recruiting other units into the mass murder of Jews. And that is part of the story of the first massacre of the Holocaust, the first mass killing in August of 1941, which I already mentioned. That mass killing at a place called Kamianets-Podilsky, which is now in southwestern Ukraine, that mass killing happens in part because police, SS, and military all cooperate. That's part of the story. There is another part of the story, the part of the story of local collaboration. And here I want to draw your attention to politics, because it's at this moment when our minds are most tempted, and you don't have to nod, I'm not going to wait for your nod. At this point, our minds are most tempted towards explanations from those people, those people, those people. What I'm struck by, you don't have to agree, but what I'm struck by is the way in which Polish peasants behave politically in almost exactly the same way as Viennese burghers when presented with the same situation. The Polish peasants of 1941 perform a political ritual in which they separate themselves from the prior regime, just as Viennese Christians did in 1938. When Germany invades the Soviet Union, right, it begins by invading Eastern Poland, the part that the Soviet Union had just annexed in 1939. When Germany reaches Białystok, which, as everyone knows, is a major Jewish city, the Germans carry out orchestrated and, I think, deliberately dramaturgical mass murder of Jews. That is, in public, during the day, they play Soviet music, they gather up the Jews of Białystok into a number of small synagogues, but also into the main shul, the main synagogue of the city, and then they burn those synagogues down and they shoot with machine guns the Jews that try to escape. And they do this in the sight of the local population. That is the model for Jedwabne and for a number of other pogroms which take place, which isn't to relieve Poles of taking responsibility for taking part in these things, which they certainly did in their thousands. It is to say that they had learned something from the Germans, right? That this was not mindless revenge against their Jewish masters, as German propaganda portrayed it, and as we are often ourselves a little bit too slightly inclined to believe, but that the Polish peasants had understood something. They had understood that this was the way that they could separate themselves from the prior regime. And in this, they were not so different, whether we like it or not, from the Viennese middle classes, who in a less dramatic moment behaved in much the same way. Now, these pogroms, as I say, become mass murder, consistent, systematic, and ever increasing levels of mass murder in the Baltic states and in the Soviet Union, but not in Eastern Poland. Why is that? Why are the Baltics so important? Why is Lithuania, Latvia, why are they so important to this history? The answer has to do, again, with politics, right? What I'm trying to insist upon is that politics in a place like Riga, or politics in a place like Vilnius, are at least as sophisticated and interesting and demanding of our attention as politics in, say, Hamburg, right? Or politics in, say, Frankfurt or Berlin. If one wants to understand the Baltics, one simply cannot say, oh, the Lithuanians, they were always more anti-Semitic than the Poles. You cannot say that. Among other things, it's just not true. The Lithuanians took more Jewish refugees than the United States of America, right? The Lithuanians and the Latvians, for that matter, also took Jewish refugees. This is a little bit of a sensitive subject, right, on this continent. They certainly took more Jewish refugees than places in Western Europe, which get a slightly easier rap. They did not have an anti-Semitic regime in the interwar period. Nevertheless, these were the places where the Holocaust starts. Why? Part of it, I think, is because the politics that I'm insisting on is much more forceful in these places. Because Lithuania and Latvia, alone in the history of the Second World War, are the states that have large Jewish populations where the state is entirely destroyed by the Soviet Union. Right? It's different than Soviet Union invading the eastern half of Poland, which is dramatic enough. In Latvia and Lithuania, the Soviet Union destroys the entire state, which means that you have political refugees from Latvia and Lithuania who go to Germany and who can be recruited. It means that you have propaganda against the Jews brought in native languages by Lithuanians and Latvians, explaining that liberation means liberation from the Jews. But it also means much deeper motives for double collaboration, right? The obvious motive of double collaboration is that you want to distance yourself from the prior regime, right? So if you're Viennese in March of 1938 and you had voted for the Fatherland Front, the way you separate yourself is to look at or take part in a humiliation of Jews. If you're a Pole in Jedwabne, and by the way, in Jedwabne, it was the Poles, not the Jews, who collaborated with the communists. This is rather important. If you're a Pole who had collaborated with the Soviets, the way that you blame the Jews is to carry out this ritual which associates the Jews with communism and then kill them. And that way the responsibility goes away. If you're in a state where the entire state has been destroyed, the depths of this political resource are much more profound. You have far more people who have carried out, who have collaborated or taken part in the Soviet regime than in Eastern Poland. And they have also suffered the humiliation, which I think we, most of us anyway, would find very difficult to imagine, of having their entire state wiped out and not resisting when that took place. Which means that in Latvia and Lithuania, uniquely, the Germans were able to call on reserves of political resources and able to bring about double collaboration on a massive scale. Now, if you don't think double collaboration is significant, I will submit to you the case of Viktor Arais. Who was Viktor Arais? He is the single most significant murderous collaborator in the Second World War. He was the head of the Arais Commando, which killed or took part in the killing of most of the Jews of Latvia, on the scale of the tens of thousands in direct murder, on the scale of the tens of thousands in collaboration. He was a Communist Party member before that. He completed law school as a communist before that. And then before that, he was a Latvian policeman. In none of those three stages of his career, the Latvian stage, the communist stage, or the mass murdering stage, is it easy to elicit some kind of ideological explanation for what he had did. But where he fits into a mainstream, as a dramatic example, is as someone in the Baltic states who had some role in the Soviet occupation, who then had some role in the mass murder of Jews. Now, I'm going to emphasize this point because it's very important. This is the place, Lithuania and Latvia, where the Germans learn that a Holocaust is possible, a Holocaust in our sense of the mass murder of the Jews. There was always a notion of a final solution, right? But it is here that they learn that a Holocaust is possible. But the Holocaust, in the form that we're talking about now, where various German institutions collaborate with ever-increasing numbers of locals, is not limited to the Baltic states. It's not limited to this zone of double occupation. It spreads into the Soviet Union just as far as German power spreads, which means that a Holocaust on this model will be carried out in Kiev, as everyone knows, at Babi Yar, in Kharkiv, in Donetsk, and all these places that have powerful anti-fascist myths. In Western Russia, on the same percentages with the same kind of local collaboration, including massive collaboration by local members of the Communist Party. Everywhere that German power goes in the Soviet Union, whether it's the doubly occupied zones or the zones of pre-war Soviet power, this kind of Holocaust will be possible. And as a result, circa 95% of the Jews who are on Soviet territory will be killed. It is this which is manifest by the end of 1941, which makes it clear to the Germans that a Holocaust is possible. And it is this which I think makes it possible for Hitler to imagine that this sort of policy can be extended back into Poland and into the rest of Europe. Now, I need to stress a couple of things here, which I'm sure you've already noticed. There, in this Holocaust, in terms of the percentage of Jews who die, there is no difference between Soviet Russia or Soviet Ukraine. There is no difference between Soviet Belarus and Soviet Ukraine. There is no difference in the collaboration of the various Soviet ethnicities. Roughly speaking, they all collaborate. There's a certain predominance among ethnic Germans for obvious reasons. They're recruited. But in general, all members of Soviet ethnicities collaborate. And, as I've already said, there is no significance to the pre-war Polish-Soviet border either. Not in terms of the percentage of Jews who die. And I think that's very significant for those of us who are looking for explanations coming from pre-war society. There is no significance to the pre-war Polish-Soviet border to a Jew's survival chances. None whatsoever. When the Holocaust comes back to Poland, as it does in 1942, it is carried out, and for the most part, in a different way, as you will all know. Poles are not armed on a large scale as Soviet citizens are. The Polish Jews who are already in ghettos are instead sent by special SS teams with the help of local Polish policemen and others into gas chambers at Belzec, Sobibor, Treblinka, Chełmno, where they will be killed. Some of the institutions of the pre-war Polish state will have been transformed, fragmented if you want, perverted in such a way that makes this possible. I'll just mention two of them to try to give some flesh to this basic argument about how destroying the state matters. I have mentioned the Polish police, right? The Polish police, the so-called blue police, the pre-war order police, the normal police, the ones who wore uniforms. I say normal. What were some of the things they did? In pre-war Poland, where anti-Semitism was a massive political problem after 1935, where the anti-Semitic National Democrats were pushing against the state, trying to disrupt it by organizing pogroms, the pre-war Polish police, the uniform police, were assigned to prevent pogroms. Why? Because pogroms are a violation of the rule of law and of the norms of a bourgeois state, right? So these same people in 1938, the same people who were preventing pogroms when Poland existed, in 1942 and 1943, the same men, with some exceptions, because of course there were Jewish Polish policemen and they've been purged, but these same men in 1942 and 1943 are hunting down Jews in the Polish countryside and killing them. Is this because they were more or less anti-Semitic at one point or the other? Perhaps. I think it's more likely because in 1938 they were part of the Polish Ministry of Internal Affairs, and in 1943 they were subordinate to a racial apparatus that was headed by Heinrich Himmler. The Judenrat. What is the Judenrat? The Judenrat usually appears on the scene in Holocaust historiography at the moment when Poland's invaded. But who are these men? The men, the local political elites in the Polish Judenrate, are the same men who were in charge of the Gmina. That is to say, the legal unit of Jewish autonomy in interwar Poland. In interwar Poland, that gmina was a place in which Jews could organize things like marriage, kosher slaughter, funeral rites, and so on, money from abroad. They were a legal part of the Polish state. When the Polish state does not exist, those same individuals behave very differently under a different order. I say this not precisely as a moral judgment, but as a part of a structural explanation, right? Because as we all know, without the Judenrat, it would have been difficult, or more difficult, let's say, to organize the transports of Jews from the ghettos to the gas chambers. Which brings me to the very last point that I want to make, which has to do with Auschwitz. I'm finishing with Auschwitz deliberately because Auschwitz is the last stage of the Holocaust. And in a certain way, Auschwitz helps to make the argument that I've been wanting to make all along. Some of you may know that the Jews who lived closest to Auschwitz, the Polish Jews who lived closest to Auschwitz, were the last Polish Jews to die. Right? And I say that just by way of reminding us all of something that we all probably know, namely that Auschwitz chronologically is the last part of the Holocaust. So there are Polish Jews who die in the Holocaust, but it's very late for the simple reason that Auschwitz comes into the Holocaust very late, in 1943 and 1944. And I stress this point because one cannot use Auschwitz as a substitute for the Holocaust as a whole. And one cannot explain the Holocaust by trying to explain Auschwitz. Auschwitz is a technical improvement over Chełmno, Sobibor, Belzec, Treblinka, which themselves were seen by the Germans as a technical improvement over mass shooting. But one cannot skip the whole history of the Holocaust, jump to Auschwitz, and then try to explain something called bureaucratized or mechanized or whatever it might be, industrial murder. That simply doesn't make sense. But what I'm struck about, and this is where I will close, what I'm struck about when I mention Auschwitz is this. A certain paradox of Auschwitz. Auschwitz does indeed represent the German ambition, or the ambition of the German leadership, to kill all of the Jews under their control. Jews from all over Europe were indeed sent to Auschwitz to die. But the striking thing about Auschwitz, or a striking thing, is that most of the Jews who were supposed to be sent to Auschwitz were not in fact sent there, right? So the death rates of people who were meant to die at Auschwitz, in other words, were much, much lower than the death rates of people who were killed locally in the places which Germany deliberately sought to make stateless. And there are reasons for this. I mean, one can look at it in a couple of ways. One is chronologically. When Germany invades Poland and the Soviet Union in 1939 and 1941, it carries out a certain kind of invasion which is deliberately meant to destroy the state, which has the political consequences, some foreseen, some unforeseen, which allow for mass killing. That invasion, as it were, cannot be redone in Belgium, the Netherlands, and France. Those occupations were carried out according to very different rules, and even when the Germans wished to do so, they could not kill Jews in the same numbers in those kinds of places. Another way to look at it is to reverse the state explanation and to ask, what are the institutions of state which actually protect Jews? And roughly speaking, it turns out to matter whether a state is sovereign in the sense of having foreign policy. Because if it does, even if it's a nasty place that we don't like Vichy France, it can change its foreign policy, right? It matters that a state has bureaucracy. Bureaucracy is the great villain in the history of the Holocaust. But the fundamental truth is, if you're a Jew recognized by a bureaucracy, your chances of survival are much, much, much better. To be killed, you have to be sent to a zone where there is no bureaucracy, in effect, right? And it matters a great deal whether you're a citizen or not, to make a point that Hannah Arendt made a long time ago. What I'm adding to her argument is that the main way to strip people from citizenship is to destroy the states of which they are citizens, right? Hence the massive death rates of Polish Jews in France. Hence the general proposition that if you were a Jew from a stateless place, your chances of surviving were 1 in 20. If you were a Jew from a place where there was a state, including Nazi Germany, including the occupied states, including the German allies, your chances of surviving were about 1 in 2, right? And to return to the comparisons that I made earlier, they all work out along this spectrum. We can talk about examples. But if one looks at the extremes, which are Denmark, where your chances of surviving were 99%, and Estonia, where your chances of dying were 99%, this is not a difference in pre-war anti-Semitism. This is a difference between the most conventional occupation and the most radical form of occupation. And so my very last comment, where I really will conclude, has to do with survival. Another way to tell this story, and I can tell it at greater length, and it's the last third of the book, has to do with the question of who can rescue. The people who can rescue are the people who are most closely connected to state institutions, right? The diplomats are not generally our heroes in Holocaust history, because we would prefer our heroes to be modest, to be dressed differently. But everyone, with a few exceptions, who rescued more than 100 Jews was a diplomat. Why? Because it was very hard to make a diplomat not a citizen. And diplomats had the almost magical capacity to extend state recognition to other people, right? Which is why the Chinese consul in Vienna, or the Japanese consul in Kaunas, right? Or Iberian diplomats in France and the Balkans, could rescue very large numbers of Jews. And insofar as rescue in general was possible, it was because people had some kind of backing from a state. If you, not the Jews now, if you, the non-Jew, were a citizen, your chance of being punished for trying to rescue a Jew were much smaller, right? If we compare Ringelblum, who created the archive in the Polish ghetto, his fate with the fate of Anne Frank, right? In the Netherlands, it was not a crime to rescue a Jew. The people who tried to rescue her were not punished because they did not violate any laws. When Ringelblum was finally caught and killed, along with a number of other Jews, they were all killed, and so were the Poles who were trying to save them, because they were not citizens and it was a crime. Which isn't to say that all Poles tried to rescue. A very small number tried to rescue. It's to say that the structures were fundamentally different, and that everywhere in Europe, it's that difference in structure rather than ethnicity which explains both survival and the attempt at rescue. We can get down to the very small number of people in Poland, the Soviet Union, or elsewhere who tried and succeeded in rescuing where there was no institutional support. But when we get down to those few thousand people, we're reaching a place of, as the Jewish sources themselves put it, we're reaching a place of Menschlichkeit. We're reaching a place of virtue, of humanity. We're reaching a place where our structural, that is our historical explanations, cannot take us. We're getting to the end or beyond the end of the story. But precisely for that reason, although these people we might see as examples in a Kantian way, if one likes, one can see them as examples to emulate, they do not redeem anyone. The Poles who rescued did not rescue in the name of the Polish nation. People rescued other people very rarely, but when they did it, they were not thinking about their nations when they did it. This is something that's very clear in the sources. And when the Jews try to explain why people rescued them, and I spent a lot of the preparatory time for this book reading the Jewish sources in Yiddish and Russian, Ukrainian, Polish, they are unable to explain what the rescuers do in these conditions, except in terms of humanity. They don't redeem a nation. They don't redeem anyone. All they do is show how a few exceptional people behaved in a case, in the place where there was no structure, in the blackest of places. What I think is that history can end there, but it can't start there. History has to start with the attempt to explain, because only when we have an explanation can we judge other people's controversies or even know what they mean. And only when we have an explanation can we draw some kind of conclusion as to what this unprecedented tragedy means for our own world. Thank you very much.
Tim, thank you very much. You made a very compelling case. I'm sure There is a lot of question in the audience. Let me briefly set up the housekeeping rules. So this event is being recorded. So I want you to all be aware of it. When you ask the question, please introduce yourself briefly. And please keep your comments and question very short so we have more participation in this. So let me open the floor.
Okay, so we'll stand up.
This point. Please.
My name is Dawn Skorczewski, and I'm from...
Grab the microphone.
My name is Dawn Skorczewski from Brandeis University. My question is about the Netherlands. It seemed to me that the Netherlands is the exception to your argument, and I just wondered if you could explain how it works.
Yeah, so the Netherlands, thank you for that. In the nature of a talk like this, I always tell my students only make one argument in a talk. And the problem with this subject is that one, in order to take it seriously, one has to make so many anterior arguments. So I want to thank you all for your patience. And it also means that I have to, in the cases, I am, with the partial exception of Poland, I'm skipping over very quickly. The Netherlands actually is a wonderful confirmation of the argument in the following way. And I particularly like the Netherlands because it gets us out of the East-West dichotomy, which often has this sort of subterranean ethnic character to it. In the West it was like this, in the East it was like this. Geography actually doesn't explain very well, but what does explain very well is the character of the dismantling of the state. So the Netherlands were special in that zone between Belgium and France and Denmark above, in that in the Netherlands, uniquely in Western Europe, the SS was in charge of the occupation. So if you accept the prior argument, which I make at length in the book, that the best way to understand the SS is as state destroyers, then one will see how the occupation of the Netherlands would have had a different character than France, which is, I think, the natural comparison, where it was more of a traditional military occupation, with some exceptions here and there, but basically a traditional military occupation. So the SS are in charge, first thing. Second thing, unlike France, which has, we don't have to like Vichy, right? One of my big points in this argument is that states that we don't like are still better than states that don't exist, right? Which is a lesson which one can learn in other times and places. But states that we don't like may still be better than states that are destroyed. So Vichy, one doesn't have to like Vichy, but it is it's a legitimate government, which everyone the U.S. recognizes, everyone sees as a legitimate government, behaves as a legitimate government, has a foreign policy and so on. It has its own anti-Semitic policies, yes. But in the Netherlands, the head of state leaves. This is really important. I mean, one might think, does it matter that a king or a queen is still around? You know, our bias is to say no. But in fact, the presence of the head of state and the presence of the government turns out to matter rather a lot. Because in their absence in the Netherlands, you have a corps of bureaucrats who have the general instruction to protect the Dutch people, who were in fact being directed increasingly by the SS. You also have a much higher number of German police, not only relatively but absolutely, in the Netherlands than you do in France and in Belgium. And there's a reason for all this, which is also relevant, which is the Netherlands were a place that the Germans had initially considered as a possible zone of annexation. They're considering a Reichskommissariat there. And it's also the only place, and this is also very revealing. Amsterdam is the only West European city where the Germans considered having a ghetto, right? And the fact that they even thought of it suggests that it's a bit more like places further to the east. So the Netherlands are actually a really important case for this argument.
Professor Mayer.
Charles Mayer. Two questions. I'm sorry, I'm Charles Mayer. He said, address me as such. A couple of questions. I mean, this is a very compelling presentation, a very eloquent talk. It rests on certain premises, and I want to ask you about them. The first premise, which you say right at the outset, is that we date the Holocaust from Barbarossa, from June 22nd, 1941. So that the Holocaust for you, and I'm not contesting, I mean, we can argue as define as we wish, is the murder of the Jews. It has nothing to do with every policy, or seems to have little to do with every policy that preceded it. The second premise, which you're very explicit about, and which is your argument, is that the state in a sense, is crucial, and that these individuals and individual behavior that counts in murder is a function of the legal carapace and what that carapace, what that state structure allows. So that Viennese burgers can flip overnight, as you call it. I don't want to be flippant about burgers, but you know, it's and so can.
I'm so glad that was your joke.
And so can the other people whose states all get absorbed or dismantled, or what? And I just, it seems to me that if you want to, that some explanatory power still maintains the fact that these states, when they existed, systematically defined Jews in many ways as second-class citizens during the preceding decade. Whether it's numerous clauses in universities, whether when Vichy exists as a state, it's the Statut des Juifs. There is, you know, does not this legal process of extruding the citizens or once citizens of when the states exist have something to do with what happens after the state exists? And this is, I find difficult. So at the end of the end, then you redeem this aspect of civic, residual civicness within people by talking about the rescuers. I agree a lot that anti-Semitism as such is not a key to where and how death rates take place, but the whole institutionalization of Jews and non-Jews in the European states, that of Eastern and Central Europe, much of it was imitated of what was going on in Germany. It seems to me that this really requires some factoring in. And it strikes me, as I think about the work in general that you've dealt, when you deal with mass murder and atrocity, so much is a question of where people live, whether it's the killing ground, whether it's the Eastern Europe, and in a certain sense, the approach is to look at a place where law is removed and other people who have a SS, which is anti-law, that's an old analysis of the double state, can come in, plays a crucial role. And I agree with some of that, but I do think that to start where you do and not to consider the prehistory leads to a type of self-fulfilling argument that you create. And as I said at the end, there are people, something about individuals and what happens to them in that period of living in quasi-lawlessness is critical. So there are some people who end up as virtuous, and a great mass of people who can have no existence or no inner moral compass except for what's provided by the most powerful force that impinges upon them, whether the Soviets, the Germans, or whatever.
Thank you, Chairman.
Okay, so let me recall each of Professor Mayer's comments and then respond briefly. The first has to do with the dating of and therefore the characterization of what the Holocaust is. I do distinguish in all of my work between final solution and Holocaust, where the final solution would be the general intention to remove Jews from the planet and the attempts that are made in that direction before 1941. And the Holocaust of the European Jews would be the actual deliberate mass murder that begins in the summer of 1941 and continues to 1944. However, I think it's an overstatement to say that that means that I think that nothing that happens before that matters. I do think that when we put the beginning of the Holocaust in its time and place, that is well beyond the boundaries of pre-war Germany and during this war of extermination, on territory which the Soviets had themselves just occupied, which I think is a fact which cannot, is almost always overlooked and which is very important. I think when one does that, it doesn't make the prior events irrelevant, but I think it authorizes us to consider them differently. So when I consider Germany in the 1930s, which I do in the book, even though in the talk I go over it very quickly, I'm considering it from a different angle, under a different magnifying glass, I think, because I'm mostly I'm concerned with Germany in the 1930s as an accumulation of potential, because so many of the institutions that exist in Germany in the 1930s, the SS, the camps, the SS higher end police leaders, they do not actually have much effect in Germany compared to what they're going to have beyond Germany. And so I'm concerned in practice, but also in theory, with what it means to have this kind of, as you call it, you were citing, you know, an earlier argument, this kind of dual power. I see it as potential rather than as something that is finished. And I see not just war, but a particular kind of state-destroying war as necessary to revealing that potential. And of course, that potential is revealed partly in terms of Hitler's ideology, partly in terms of what the essayists think they're going to do, but partly in terms of what they find out they can do, right? So in the crucial case of the Baltic states and the crucial case of local collaborators, the Germans in the beginning do not think they're going to be arming locals on a large scale. In fact, they're forbidden from doing so. Nevertheless, within 2 weeks, they're doing so. And within 2 months, locals are taking part in shootings on a very large scale. And that is because of things they learn, things that they did not expect. And that's part of the fulfillment. Okay, the second question is about state structure. And here I think we may more straightforwardly disagree here. Because it relates to the first question. I find the narrative of how German Jews are discriminated against, although necessary in and of itself, basically misleading for how the Holocaust is going to proceed after that. The main consequence in terms of Jewish survival for what it does to Jews, right? I'm not talking about what it does to Germans, of say Aryanization, is that German Jews immigrate. That's the main consequence. You don't have to have Aryanization in Germany to have a Holocaust in the Soviet Union. In fact, strikingly, these are the kinds of things I flesh out in the book. One thing which is interesting about the Soviet occupation is that they're much better at expropriation than the Germans are, right? They're also much better at deportation. But by the time the Germans arrive, because that's what they do, right? By the time the Germans arrive in the Baltic states, expropriation has gone very, very, very far. And of course, it wasn't, by the Soviets, it wasn't directed at the Jews, but it was directed among other people at the Jews, which meant that when the Germans arrive, all the Latvians or Lithuanians claim the Jewish property. The Germans say, if Jews try to get their own property back, it's looting, which is punishable by death. And this creates a property incentive for the murder of Jews, which is very, very important. The whole step of Aryanization of German Jews is not relevant to that. It's not necessary, even though property, I think, is extremely important. Or to take this more broadly, if you look at the cases of Estonia, Latvia, Lithuania, and the pre-war Soviet Union, you just don't have the same progression, right? So you mentioned places like France or Hungary where there were, but in Lithuania and Latvia, there weren't this, and Austria as well, and certainly not in the Soviet Union. And yet in the Soviet Union, one gets the highest rate of Jewish death anywhere with a state which was angled in exactly the opposite direction. So, I mean, what I tend to think is that this business of separating the Jew from the state is important, but the Germany in the 1930s is in effect doing it retail, whereas Germany after 1941 learns to do it wholesale, after 38 learns to do it wholesale, and so I in a way I accept, you know, the Arendt or the Hilberg argument about separating the individual from the state, or about the end of the judicial person in man. But what I think is that destroying the state allows you to short circuit that whole process. You don't actually have to go through all the intermediate steps. You can simply destroy the state. And the Soviet Union is the case, I guess, which shows that to me most dramatically. Or if one wants to stay in more comfortable ground, comparing Austria to Germany, right? Where in the 6 weeks after Anschluss, there was as much, if not more, discrimination of Austrian Jews than there had been in Germany in the previous 6 years, without all the prior steps. On then this question of anti-Semitism, I want to agree with you that it matters. And one of the things I'm concerned about is trying to specify where it matters. Because analytically, I worry that when it's applied very broadly, we then don't see where it does matter. And there certainly are places where it matters. So the Poles who work on 1941 and 1943, here's the part where I'm going to say they're right. It does matter. If you're looking at the summer of 1941, what the local politics of a place were before the war. That does partly predict whether there's going to be a pogrom or not. And in 1943, when some Polish peasants are trying to rescue Jews, one of the many problems they have, the biggest problem they have, is the total culture of denunciation, which is not anti-Semitic, but which is just general. But one of the problems they have is that when they know that their neighbors voted National Democratic before the war. That is, when they know that their neighbors are anti-Semitic, they're more anxious about things, and understandably so. So there are certainly places where anti-Semitism does matter. But I want us to be able to specify where it matters more and where it matters less. And just to be clear, I don't think that any of this at the end redeems anything, except perhaps, you know, maybe as you were maybe suggesting, applying redemption in a very neutral, pragmatic way, civic life, right? And that is possibly redeemed. Or if we're to unmix the metaphors, something interesting to say about religion is this. There's a lot of controversy about which religions are better and worse, right? If people look at France, they say, well, you know, the Protestants were lovely and the Catholics less so. If you look at it, I mean, this research is still in this preliminary stage, but if you look at it in a pan-European way, it turns out that it's not the content of the liturgy that matters, but rather the pre-war relationship between the church and the state. So that in the comparative work which has been done on French Catholics and Protestants, Dutch Catholics and Protestants, what turns out is that if you're a member of a religion that was a minority locally, you're much more likely to rescue. And then this applies in the Soviet Union as well, where the persecuted Protestant denominations, Baptists, for example, were much more likely to rescue Jews than anyone else, which confirms the state argument. Because when the state goes away, the state religions, classic example, Roman Catholicism in Poland, which is not formally a state religion, but which is de facto the main religion, the state religions, when the state goes away, those people tend to be much less likely to rescue than people who are in minority religions, which confirms the argument I'm trying to make about the state and its importance.
Professor Bonikowski. Wait for the mic.
Oh, sorry. Should I repeat that? Barbara Bonikowski from Sociology. Thank you. This is a fascinating talk. I find the structural explanation quite compelling. I do have a question about its implications for sort of a social psychology that's kind of part of the mechanism in some ways of what you're talking about. Because the assumption, and really it's about the relation between individual and the state. When the state disappears, all of a sudden individuals do things that they wouldn't otherwise do, which is sort of following up on Charlie's question. So is it that this is sort of a Hobbesian model, right? There's kind of a potential for mass violence and killing. The state sort of keeps it at bay, but when the state disappears, you know, people's darker sides are unleashed. Or is it something else? And you sort of alluded to some other potential mechanisms, like the fact that those who collaborated with the previous state most closely were the ones who were most likely to then participate in the violence, as if sort of overdoing an attempt to show that they're now part of the new regime. Or is it something altogether different? So I guess I'm sort of wondering about the motivations of people when the state disappears. And how do we think about that?
Okay, so one of the nice things about being a historian, right, is that I never have to answer those questions of like, was it that or was it that or was it the other thing, right? Because everything that you name applied with different force at different times and places. So let me take your list and let me try to rephrase or recharacterize a few of them. One of the things which happens is that from the beginning, if the Germans are going to treat a given state in a colonial way, that is, as not really existing, Poland and the Soviet Union, that means the way they occupy is different. So it does matter, for example, that for every French bureaucrat that was hired under Vichy, a Polish bureaucrat was murdered, right? That matters. It's a different form of occupation. It matters that the Einsatzgruppen were assigned to murder what was identified as the political class in Poland and the Soviet Union. It's a different form of occupation. The society itself is changed by that in ways that it's hard to specify, but wiping out local elites probably does change a society, and that's from the beginning. A second thing which happens, and I didn't have time to be clear about these things in the talk, but the second thing which happens is the observation of deprivation of rights. Right. So Polish peasants, just to take the Polish example, it's not unique. Polish peasants observing Jews losing their property. First of all, take that property. Right. So Poles took Jewish property. Everyone knows that. They also took the property of Polish soldiers who didn't return from the front. You know, this is normal human behavior. But they took Jewish property when they observed that Jews are being sent to ghettos. And that's a result of statelessness. And it seems so banal, but it's really important in the sense that the Germans said, no, the Polish state doesn't exist, the Polish civil code no longer functions. And ghettoization is part of that. And then that has that local sociological consequence that people then fight for the property. And the social psychology is, if I don't take it, you're going to. right? I'm not a bad person for taking this, because if I don't, you're going to take this. And that's, of course, true, right? I mean, there's an unresolvable prisoner's dilemma there. Someone is going to take that Jewish property, and quickly. And so, you know, thinking about your family, you take it. And because the Poles themselves were not citizens in the Wartegau and the general government, because they themselves were, in general, deprived increasingly as the war went by, part of it was this kind of comparative deprivation, that these people are deprived absolutely and we're deprived relatively, but that means we're more likely to take what's being taken from them. A third thing which happens is the fragmentation of prior states. So I'm trying to avoid an abstraction, like I'm trying to avoid a Hobbesian abstraction, right? Because for a lot of reasons, one of them is that it's too clear cut, and another is that one of the things that one is doing in this kind of argument is one is testing Hitler's own hypothesis, right? Because Hitler himself, I mean, at least if I'm right about Hitler, right? I could be wrong, other people could be right, but if I'm right, Hitler was not an authoritarian, but more so, not a nationalist, but more so, but rather a kind of zoological anarchist. And his view was, when you clear away institutions completely, we're going to return to a natural state of racial conflict, right? And so in a way, the whole Second World War is a kind of, or on the Eastern Front anyway, is a kind of test of that. And I don't want to say that that's right. I mean, obviously one wasn't, that wasn't saying it, but also what happens is partly that when they go in to destroy structures, and here's where Hitler's wrong in a lot of places, but here's where Hitler is wrong as a sociologist, it's not that you can ever clear the field completely of politics. And this goes back to Charlie Mayer's introduction to his question, which I want to agree with. I'm trying to insist in this work that politics never ends, that new forms of politics constantly thrust themselves up, right? And that often helps. Sometimes it hurts, but that often helps the expansion, the extension of the Holocaust. So as states are destroyed, if you'll pardon the metaphor, one of the things that happens is that fragments are tossed out. And I mentioned a couple of examples of this. The Judenrat, right? The Judenrat is not created out of nothing. It's a fragment of a previously existing Polish order. Imperfect, right? But the Polish police who are guarding the ghettos, and the Polish police who are sometimes hunting down Jews in 42, 43, 44, they were part of a pre-war order which did something else. Those things are fragments, right? So the field is never entirely clear. And one of the ways it's not entirely clear is the one you emphasize, the social psychological. If a state is destroyed, history doesn't begin again when it's destroyed a second time, right? 1 + 1 = 0, 1 + 1 = 2. And so if Latvia is destroyed by the Soviet Union, that creates all kinds of psychological potentials, which we can only describe, I think, generally, which the Germans can then intentionally exploit or learn to exploit. And that's the special, so I agree with you, like there's the specific case of any state destruction, right? If the political order is gone in New Orleans or Iraq or wherever it might be, people are going to behave in a certain way. And then there's the specific case of the double state destruction. And that's an argument which I'm trying to make very neutrally, because I'm not concerned to say like the Soviets were just as bad as the Germans, or the Soviets had direct responsibility for the Holocaust. That's not my point at all. But my point is that the Soviets were very refined state destroyers. And as a matter of historical contingency, they destroyed state apparatus just before the Germans came in and destroyed the Soviet state apparatus. And that particular constellation created psychological potential, which I think was not present elsewhere. And that's why I was trying to emphasize the difference between Eastern Poland and, say, Lithuania or Latvia, because it's just not the case that Lithuania and Latvia were more anti-Semitic than Eastern Poland. It's just not the case. But here you have a double state destruction, and here you have single.
Professor Ferguson.
Neil Ferguson, Tim, this is a very impressive presentation, and I want to congratulate you on the books upon which it's based. I haven't read the latest book, so forgive me if I ask you to talk about something that's in there but you didn't have space for this afternoon. I think you've succeeded in making the Holocaust less narrowly German, making the historical strife seem rather parochial, making us alert to its Europeanness, and you've done that by reading sources and using languages that other historians neglected, and I think you to be congratulated for that. And I think you've made an argument which is persuasive in the sense that you emphasize this double destruction, sometimes single destruction, of state structures as a prelude to genocide, as opposed to, say, earlier anti-Semitic proclivities. But I'm left wondering if this is still too European a story and not a sufficiently global one. And I wanted you to talk a little bit about precedents, antecedents. The destruction of states was common practice. You just alluded to it in something you said in the Q&A, in colonial contexts, and the notion that annihilation was permissible where there was terra nullius is familiar to any student of the settlement of the Americas. So could you talk a little bit about whether there is still a place for those colonial antecedents in your story, how big a part they played in German conceptions of empire, which these were, after all? And secondly, where in the story do you place that curiously modernistic pseudoscience, racial science, that was a new element that the 18th century or 17th century settlers hadn't had, and is a big part of, say, Michael Burley's account of what is going on? Are those written out of the story, or are they in the book but not in the talk?
Right. So the book is unfortunately a lot like the talk, it's an argumentative book. So whereas in Bloodlands I was trying in a way to clear the decks, I was trying to provide what I hoped was a self-defending account of mass killing policies on a certain territory. Where, you know, among the conclusions is the conclusion that the Holocaust is over-theorized and misunderstood. In this book, I'm swinging much more towards the side of interpretation and making a lot of arguments, which is just a prologue of saying that yes, I mean to a fault probably I address all of these conceptual issues. Let me respond in three ways. The first is to broaden this still further. By speaking not just in terms of global antecedents, but speaking of the global study, the contemporary social scientific global study of ethnic cleansing and genocide. Because if one contemplates that for a moment, one sees that my argument turns out to be almost unbelievably mainstream. It turns out that's not my phone because I forgot mine. It turns out that what I am actually agreeing with everyone. Because in the social scientific literature on ethnic cleansing and genocide, which has matured and become quite impressive in the 25 years basically since Srebrenica, right, since Yugoslavia, when ethnic cleansing moved from a term of art to a term of science, the big finding of those studies and of the studies of studies, which also exist, is that it's not the strong authoritarian state which is most strongly associated with ethnic cleansing and genocide, but rather state failure. Right, total state failure or partial state failure. That is extremely interesting when one considers the Germans, because of course Germany is not a failed state, right? But Germany is a place which artificially elicits state failure in its neighbors, which as far as I can tell in European history is unprecedented. Now, if you're a historian, you look at that social scientific body of literature and the studies of studies and all that empirical stuff and you say, well, yes, but of course there are exceptions, right? Because that's what we're paid to do. We say, I know some exceptions to that generalization. And we do. We know some exceptions. We know some states which killed their own citizens, not during state failure, but as a result of state power. The major exceptions are Cambodia, People's Republic of China, and the Union of Soviet Socialist Republics. And then the thing that one says about those exceptions are, interestingly, those are all party states. I'm bracketing the issue of communism because it's actually not important. Those are all for this. These are all party states. And then one sees how I'm agreeing with everybody. Because what is unique about Nazi Germany is that it is a party state, right, where the most relevant connection from the citizen to the polity is not to the state but to the party. It's a party state which artificially elicits state failure in its neighbors. In other words, the thing I'm arguing about Nazi Germany actually brings together these two major strands of contemporary scholarship about mass killing and genocide generally. Okay, then more to the literal reading of your question. Yes, so as Professor Ferguson indicates, one of the major issues of contention, maybe the major one in the last 15 years or so in Holocaust studies has been global or not global. This has been argued out in some unbelievably unpleasant ways. For me, it seems presumptively obvious, at least, that the history of European and German colonialism has something to do with the history of German colonialism in Eastern Europe. And the question is just exactly how one makes that connection. I would point to two major lines of causal connection. The first has to do with racial ideology.
In other words, that Hitler, and not only Hitler, but many other German colonialists, took for granted that the American colonization, or see, they would see it, the European colonization of North America and the European colonization of Africa were fundamentally racial enterprises. And one can cite at length, you know, the German colonialists in Africa comparing their colonies to Wyoming. You know, this sort of thing was just normal. That's how they thought about it. When they killed the Herero, they said, the natives must give way. Look at the United States, right, where the natives had to give way. Those kinds of things were totally normal. I wouldn't want to make the case that you go directly from there to Poland in 1939. I would just say that Hitler took for granted that colonialism was racial. The racial colonialism, however, was not directed against the Jews. I mean, this is a misunderstanding or this is a shortcut. It's directed against the Ukrainians. The Ukrainians, the Slavs in general, the Ukrainians in particular, are the ones who are characterized as the racial inferiors. And we have a problem with that, we Americans, as if you're not American, can zone out. We have a problem with that because of our own racial way of seeing the world, where we think of racism as pigmentation prejudice, right? Which I think is our own racial problem. Racism can be much more consistent than that, or much more self-aware, or whatever. Hitler had no problem speaking about Ukrainians the same way he spoke about Africans. And there's no logical problem with that. It just happens to be the case. And so he characterized the Soviet Union as the colonial territory which was left open to Germany. Where the Jews come into that is indirectly, because according to the ideology, as I very briefly summarized it, all these ideas, all these universalistic ideas of solidarity are Jewish, including communism, which means the Soviet Union is a Jewish state, which Hitler says is our good fortune, because it means if we attack the Soviet Union, the Jews won't fight, the whole state will collapse. It will collapse like a house of cards, says Hitler. It will collapse like a giant with feet of clay, citing the Book of Daniel. This is Hitler's view on the Soviet Union. And so by that route, you're led to the Holocaust for the very simple reasons that this is where the Jews are. So between, if you're going to conquer Ukraine from Berlin, you're going to pass over the major zone of Jewish settlement, which makes, it's simple, but that makes possible the Holocaust. The thing that I would say about racial science is that I think there the connections are a little bit more indirect. The perfection of Germans led to certain techniques, like the mass murder of the so-called handicapped in the so-called euthanasia project, which were then applied further east. But as I understand it anyway, the perfection, the racial hygiene part, the perfection of the German race falls well into the background once the racial colonization and then the extermination of the Jews accelerate. This is Peter Longerich makes this argument, I think, in a very elegant form, where he speaks of the positive and the negative. The positive racial project of perfecting the German turns out to be very difficult and to have some inherent logical problems, whereas the negative projects of destroying other races turn out to be tragically easier to achieve.
Sarah, please.
Hi, my name is Joseph Pollack. I'm very taken with this understanding of the Holocaust, and I want to thank you for with all the things that you're pulling together. My question is about Wannsee. Mm-hmm. So here you have this gang of thugs headed by Heydrich, and getting basic instructions out of Berlin by the top group, and my question is, to what extent are these guys really in touch with the issues that you raise? In other words, to what extent do they have a sense that we have to destroy regimes and then kill the Jews? And where is that going on at all in their heads? Or are they all just acting, as I suspect they are, without any sophisticated history or political science, and they're just responding in the moment? That's my question.
It's a very interesting question, and I'm gonna dodge it, and then I'm gonna try to answer it. Here comes the dodge. The dodge is, let's ask not for a second what they were thinking, but let's see what the events of Wannsee themselves say about this argument, because I think they show a couple of interesting things. The first is that at Wannsee, if you read what we have of the records of the conference, one of the major problems was defining what a German Jew was. And I think this is, you know, this, if you think of Wannsee as the place where the Holocaust was planned, this can kind of fall into the background. But in terms of the amount of ink that it takes up, I think this is actually the major issue. And this is very interesting because it shows the contradictions that not only an authoritarian anti-Semitic state, but even Nazi Germany falls into when it's trying to extract its own citizens from its own polity. It turns out to be really difficult to extract people without destroying the polity. And of course, the paradox is that even if Hitler is, as I believe he was, an anarchist, you still have to care about the German polity because the German polity is there to destroy other polities and to begin this larger process of racial redemption. So even if you're Hitler, even if you're Goebbels, even if you're people who believe in this more radical view, you can't toss aside the German polity. You have to care about that. And so Wannsee reveals, in a way, just how difficult the project was inside Germany and how it became easier outside. That's the second point I wanted to make, and it blurs a little bit towards your question. By the time we get to the original scheduled time of Wannsee, which was December 41, and then the actual meeting, which was January 42, around a million Jews have already been killed. And they've been killed in a way which was not foreseen, but which is increasingly ordered and increasingly centralized, which is by mass shootings over pits. And on my account, this, in a way, must change how we see Wannsee. Because even if Wannsee had never happened, even if they delayed it for another 6 months or whatever, that form of the killing of Jews would still have continued. And if one looks at the numbers of Wannsee, which I can't cite them off the top of my head, but what's interesting about the numbers in Wannsee is that it's a total of 11 million, I think, and a lot of the Jews they're talking about are going to be Jews that they never actually kill, because those Jews, and again, my argument, are in sovereign states, and by early 42, it's too late to change that. And so even though they wish to extract those Jews, they're not going to be able to do it. Okay, now let me try to answer your question as you put it. I think that a lot of the things which the Germans learned could not be put down on paper in a straightforward way. So let me give you an example. When the Germans move into Soviet-occupied Eastern Poland, Soviet-occupied Baltic states, the Soviet Union itself, the pre-war Soviet Union, they think that, and they know that they're supposed to think, that the local non-Jews are going to rise up against their Jewish masters. That's their propaganda, and you know the orders that Heydrich gives are along the lines of instigate this, you know, make it look like the locals took part, deny, you know, create what we would call plausible deniability. But the expectation is a little bit of a push, and you'll get all kinds of pogroms. That doesn't happen. Now, are there reports from, you know, Eastern Poland back to Berlin saying, we were wrong, these pogroms didn't happen? No, there aren't that kind of report. Instead, you have suggestive things coming from Lithuania later along the lines of, we may have here, this is Ohlendorf, we may have here an unanticipated opportunity to more quickly resolve the Jewish problem. I'm paraphrasing, but it's something like that, September 1941, where they're not contradicting directly what was supposed to happen, but they're saying, you know, as it were, things are going better than we've expected. And they're going better than we expected because these people experimented and did things for which they didn't actually have centralized orders, probably. And so I do think there was a kind of learning that was going on, but it could never be articulated in the way which contradicted the initial assumptions because of the nature of the regime. I mean, a good example of that point would be Hitler himself, circa Wannsee. So circa Wannsee, December 41, January 42, Hitler is dealing with a major geopolitical problem, going back to the world scale, which is that he finds himself in a war with simultaneously Great Britain, the Soviet Union, and the United States of America, which, you know, just couldn't have been part of the plan. And he needs a way to explain what has happened. And of course, and so the way he explains it is that this only confirms that in fact the Jews are more important on Wall Street and Fleet Street and in, you know, the Kremlin than we had thought, because look, this improbable communist capitalist alliance against us is possible, which means we have to press even harder on the Jews who are under our control. In other words, he turns almost certain defeat in the colonial war into an argument for pressing further in the war against the Jews. But of course he can't say I was wrong or the initial premises of this war were wrong. So one has to decode it in that way. So one's never going to be able to answer that kind of question with direct quotations. But my feeling is that yes, they were learning about a new kind of politics that they themselves were creating. Oh, and this goes back to something I wanted to say to Neil Ferguson, which I forgot to say. I think we do have to Europeanize at the end, and here's why. It is the case, as you quite rightly say, that the Germans draw their legal language about what they're going to do in Poland from European colonies. They claim that not only Poland is not a state, but that it never was a state. Interestingly, the Soviets say the same thing about Estonia, by the way, but that it never was a state, and that so therefore the general government is not an occupation zone. They remove the word occupation. They remove the word besetzt. On the logic, you can't have an occupation unless you're occupying something. And since there was no Poland to be occupied, the general government is just called the general government, as opposed to the general government of the occupied Polish lands. They initially call it that, and then they change their, then they realize the mistake they've made, and they go to general government. And this is important, I think, for what happens, because part of what I'm claiming is that it does matter that there, that a European state destroyed a very similar European state, right? So whatever the political structures in, say, you know, the Iroquois nation, right, in New York, whatever. These are political structures which the French, you know, in the, managed to use in certain ways. But it's they were what they were not was a comparable European state. Look at that from any kind of distance. Poland in 1938 and Germany in 1938 are rather similar places, rather similar social structures, rather similar kinds of states. And one European state destroying another European state has consequences that that I think other kinds of efforts don't have. Fragments break out in ways that they wouldn't have broken out in Africa or North America. And in that very specific way, I think it then comes back and is a European story.
This is the conclusion of the first part of the Zaleski lecture. You are all invited tomorrow at noon to the Center for European Studies for the panel discussion about the book. And please join me to thank Professor Snyder for this presentation.
Thank you, Gregor. Thank you. Thank you very much. Thank you.